The colonization of the moon. The only natural satellite of the Earth is present in many movies and science fiction novels. Think, for example, to Arthur C. Clarke, who before becoming famous as a screenwriter with 2001, A Space Odyssey, together with Stanley Kubrick, wrote The Exploration of the Moon, one of the first novels to propose the construction of a lunar base with scientific criteria, consisting of inflatable modules covered with regolith to isolate them and protect the occupants from radiation. Clarke also describes the construction of gradually larger domes of an algae-based air generator, of a nuclear reactor for the generation of energy, of electromagnetic cannons capable of launching into space the material to be transferred on a spacecraft in a near-rectilinear halo cislunar orbit. That is a type of lunar orbit with the perihelion, the point of the orbit closest to the moon at 3,000 kilometers from the lunar surface, and apolunium, the point of the orbit farthest from the moon at 70,000 kilometers from the moon. These values minimize the periods in which contact with the Earth is lost. Clarke's vision, through the description of many details, underlines some of the problems that a stable garrison on the moon must face, and which we will discuss in this video. Now let's see what the problems and real prospects of the incredible adventure are today. The first problem to be faced to colonize the moon is to identify a suitable site which must have the following characteristics. 1. Terrain sufficiently regular to allow surface transport operations, landing, and takeoff of lunar spaceships. 2. A potentially interesting area from a scientific point of view to facilitate study activities without dangerous long transfers. 3. Maximum possible availability of natural resources such as water, hydrogen, helium, oxygen, and minerals of industrial interest such as iron oxides. Can you think of others? Write them in the comments. These characteristics can be found in various lunar areas, but all analysis suggests to carefully consider polar regions too. First of all, there is evidence of the presence of water ice, especially on the bottom of the craters that are never reached by sunlight. Then you have in mind that, due to the inclination of the axis on which the Earth rotates, at latitudes higher than or at least equal to those of the polar circles, north or south, the sun can remain above the horizon even throughout the night, for various periods up to a maximum of 6 months, depending on the greater or lesser proximity to the geographic pole. It follows that during these periods, the polar regions receive sunlight for a longer continuous time than the equatorial areas. Something similar also happens on the moon. This would make possible the production of photovoltaic energy to support other forms of production, nuclear reactors and fuel cells. Thanks to the geographical position, temperatures should be more stable. However, the lunar equatorial regions were not completely excluded from the assessments. Some advantageous aspects could counterbalance the negative ones. For example, the spectroscopic observations have revealed a fair abundance of helium-3, rare on Earth, which could become essential if a technology is developed that allows controlled nuclear fusion. In addition, the greater rotation speed of the equatorial area and above, all the fact that the lunar equator is slightly inclined with respect to the ecliptic, would make takeoffs at those latitudes and the resulting translunar and terrestrial routes more advantageous. Various hypotheses of lunar bases, both superficial and underground, are currently being studied. In any case, they must be designed to protect astronauts from radiation because the moon lacks a global magnetic field. Some hypotheses include, for example, the installation of surface igloos covered with a layer of regolith, the dust that covers the lunar surface, several decimeters thick. Other places, the bases on the bottom of the craters, in ravines similar to caves or in tunnels to be excavated in the subsoil. But this last step may not even be necessary, as on the moon, there are already natural cavities potentially suitable for housing habitable structures, lava tunnels. What is it about? Very ancient volcanic eruptions have created in the subsoil real conduits dug by the lava, in some cases of immense size. Lava tunnels are ideal for a settlement because they are protected from radiation and meteorites, They are extremely solid structures and guarantee a limited thermal excursion with an average temperature that could be around negative 23 degrees Celsius, which can be countered with heaters. Surely life would be underground, away from any source of natural light and without the spectacle of the starry sky and the Earth rising on the horizon. But a welcoming housing technology could limit the discomfort. How would you feel to live in one of these bases, perhaps for very long periods? Write it in the comments. In the lava tunnels, or in any case underground, relatively simple modules could be placed, for example, with a honeycomb structure, easier to make than surface structures, which should be suitably shielded. But undoubtedly, it is these surface bases that have sparked the imagination of designers and scientists. The proposed habitats range from the appropriately modified holds of the landing vehicles to their emptied fuel tanks. From inflatable modules of all shapes to prefabricated structures to be assembled. Regolith, essentially composed of a mixture of silicon and iron containing compounds, could be hot melted to produce a supposedly very strong and fairly radiation shielding glass coating. The European Space Agency is experimenting with the construction of real regolith bricks, exploiting a quarry of material called AEC1, very similar to the lunar regolith. In 2013, a study was released that theorized the use of a special 3D printer capable of using lunar regolith as a material to produce external support structures that enclose inflatable habitats. According to the study, this solution would drastically reduce the amount of building material to be transported to the moon. It would be enough to mix the regolith with a magnesium oxide to create a new fluid material that, once solidified, would be completely similar to stone. In addition to the underground and surface bases, the hypothesis of an international lunar base in orbit around the moon is also emerging, to give which various space agencies would contribute a lunar orbital platform gateway. According to the project, it should consist of 7 modules plus a robotic arm supplied by Canada, reaching 125 cubic meters of living space. Power and Propulsion Element, PPE, is a module with a weight of 8 to 9 tons designed to produce 50 kilowatts of electricity through photovoltaic panels and provide ion propulsion. On May 23, 2019, the assignment of construction to Maxar Technologies was announced, and it will constitute the first module of the station. European System Providing Refueling Infrastructure and Telecommunications, ESPRIT, will contribute to the storage of xenon and hydrazine, as well as providing a docking point for any cargo. It will be designed in parallel by Airbus and Thales Alenia Space. Habitation and Logistics Outpost, HALO, made in the US, will provide additional space and form the initial housing module, leading to 55 cubic meters of living space. It will be based on a Cygnus spacecraft, with the additions of radiators, antennas, batteries, and docking points, providing support for the crew for at least a month. The construction of the module was entrusted in July 2019 to Northrop Grumman, which, for the production of the Cygnus, collaborates with Thales Alenia Space, operating in the pressurized sections. International Habitation Module, IHAB, is part of the habitation module during manned missions and is a docking point for other modules. It has a cylindrical shape with the addition of 4 doors, 2 in axis and 2 radial, and for the absence of space waste in the cislunar area, less thick walls are sufficient. Inside, there will be sleeping, kitchen, and a gym. It will be designed in parallel by Airbus and Thales Alenia Space. At the ESA Ministerial Conference in Seville, an order worth 327 million euros was awarded for the module, 137 million of which for Italian returns. U.S. Habitation Module, U.S. HAB, forms the U.S. part of the station's housing module, reaching 125 cubic meters of living space. Gateway Logistics Modules will be used as refueling modules. The project provides for a pressurized load capacity of 5 tons and 2.6 tons of non-pressurized, for a total of 7.6 tons. In comparison, the Cygnus and the ATV reach 3.5 tons and 9 tons. Gateway Airlock Module will act as an airlock for any spacewalks and will be provided by Russia. But have you ever wondered why colonize the moon? One of the most important reasons is certainly the technological fallout, that is, the applications derived from space missions that we use in everyday life. Think about the Apollo missions have produced more than 160,000 technological fallouts. Let's see a very brief summary. Infrared ear thermometer. Diatech Corporation and NASA developed an ear thermometer that measures the thermal radiation emitted by the eardrum using the same principle to evaluate the temperature of stars and planets. Artificial limbs. The development of robotics linked to manipulation equipment in space. For example, the Canada arm of the space shuttle and the creation of low-cost materials have allowed important progress in the field of active limb prosthetics. Translucent polycrystalline alumina. Born as a protective coating of infrared antennas to detect the position of rockets through the heat trace. It is now used in dentistry as a coating for fragile teeth and to make invisible plates for dental appliances. Anti-scratch lenses. The particular coating that makes the lenses of our glasses resistant to scratches was created to protect the visors of astronauts' helmets. Left ventricular assistance, LVAD. NASA engineers designed turbopumps for the Apollo engine. This technology has resulted in a medical device capable of supporting patients with heart failure while awaiting transplantation. Medical emitting diodes, LEDs, created as light emitters in plant growth stimulation experiments in space. These types of high-intensity diodes were used by Quantum Devices, Inc., under license from NASA, to manufacture radiating equipment for the localized treatment of joint and muscular pain. Thermal control garments. Microclimate technology is used in the liquid cold garment. The garments that astronauts wear under the pressurized suits, ensuring thermal comfort thanks to a system of tubes in which a fluid heat exchanger powered by a mini battery pump. Life Support Systems Inc. has created clothing for immobilized patients, such as children with ectodermal dysplasia. These children overheat rapidly due to the abnormalities in the sweat glands and suffer from a number of serious related ailments. The LSSI products contribute significantly to avoiding thermal shock and other complications. The same principle has also been applied to technical clothing for firefighters and other workers exposed to strong heat sources. Isothermal blanket. In aluminized blankets, often found in first aid kits, were invented in 1964 by NASA as a thermal coating for spacecrafts. An example, the Apollo Lunar Module. They consist of a thin plastic sheet, usually PET, coated with a metal material that reflects up to 75% of the radiated heat. Firefighting devices. NASA has issued concessions to produce high-tech breathing systems used by firefighters and flame-resistant radio connections. These NASA-designed equipment is much safer and lighter than its predecessors, ensuring better mobility and vision for firefighters. Freezing drying process. In anticipation of long-duration missions, NASA has conducted extensive research on food. One of the techniques adopted and improved was that of freezing drying food, developed in 1938 by Nestle. Foods are cooked, frozen, and then slowly heated in a vacuum chamber to remove the ice crystals. The final product retains 98% of its nutritional value and weighs much less, up to 20% of its original weight. Today, this process makes it possible to serve quality meals in emergency situations, but also to market products that were previously impossible to preserve. And do you come up with other technological implications? Write them in the comments.